Are you ever reading the Bible and you kind of don't know how to apply it to your life? Like, it's the Bible. Like, of course it applies to your life. Like, of course there's supposed to be stuff that you get from it. But you're honestly kind of like, okay, now what? Okay, so I just read like 7 genealogies and 1 Kings and I'm lost. Or, okay, that's really cool that the early church did this, but how does that apply to my life? I think we often read the Bible for that application, but then by the time we've read the Bible, we forget to apply it to our lives because we're so tired from reading the Bible. So today I'm gonna talk to you about how to always get like biblical application and not to get some like weird off the wall, weird theology, but like biblically based theological application. Let's begin. How do I want to say this? I don't know how to say this without sounding really rude, but I, every so often, get crazy people up in my email, up in my comments. They say the weirdest, most off the wall stuff. And sometimes I wonder, who are you reading? Are you going to church? Like, is there a pastor that's influencing the way that you're applying the scriptures to life? Or is this just like you sitting up in your attic reading by yourself? Because I've said before, like, you gotta study the word in fellowship. You gotta study God's word, not by yourself. You need to be in church. You need to be listening to pastors. You need to be reading other theologians because you are therefore holding yourself accountable to the biblical theology of the historical church. I recently told you guys, you know, to study the 7 ecumenical councils, to study church history because the church has faced heresy. And what I mean by heresy is like false teaching or lies, like twisting God's word, twisting God's truth. We want to make sure that we don't keep repeating those patterns and keep bringing them up in our own sinful nature. So I will every so often get some crazy comments up in here. I had somebody, I mean, I don't even need to mention it. I mean, I want to be careful because I want to love and I don't want to hate on anybody. It's hard because like we can all so easily fall into heresy or a wrong application of the scriptures or a wrong way of viewing something because we're sinners, because we are dirty, because we are hopeless without Christ and without Christ leading us. When you are reading through the Bible and you hit genealogies or you hit even just something crazy that Paul's saying and you're like, what does he mean? I want you to have some basic guidelines on how to apply that to your life. And as someone who studied Bible in undergrad and now I'm finishing up my seminary degree, I'm a pastor's wife, I feel like I have a pretty good idea of, or a pretty good taste, especially because I've been in a lot of different denominations in my life, of like how to apply the Bible pretty flawlessly every time. Now that's not a hard and truth rule for a fact, because you also want to pay attention to like a bajillion other things, and it is complicated, but I want to boil it down and make it simple for you guys. Okay, so here we go. If you're reading through the Bible today, or if you're just like reading a random verse and you're like, how do I understand the Bible? How do I read and understand and then apply the Bible? Like, those are 3 really important things. First off, read. I'm not a big person that says just read a verse a day. No, like read at least a paragraph. Read in context. 2, understand. So grab a commentary, read what other people have said about that paragraph or that passage that you've just read. There's free commentaries online. There's free sermons online. Like, hear what somebody else has said if you're struggling with understanding that passage. And then 3, apply. You know, you can read and understand the Bible all day long, but if that doesn't affect the way you live, like apply to your own life, then it does nothing. When you are applying the scriptures to your life, this is a little risky for me to say this, I would encourage you to not say, how have I always been taught how to apply this to my life? Because oftentimes society will tell you this is what the scripture means, and it's kind of wrong. I would ask yourself, what did Jesus or the writer or the author of this passage want the original person to do? It's very similar to when I tell you guys to read God's word, asking what the original author meant and what the original audience were supposed to understand. It's that same kind of thing, but it's doing. Okay, let's think of the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. All those really weird, paradoxical statements. The world understands it to not be a blessing if you mourn, but Jesus is saying you are blessed if you mourn. So you might have read this passage and you might like kind of understand what Jesus is getting at, but how do you apply this to your life? You don't want to go like, you know, singing and praising the Lord at someone's funeral. Like, how do you apply the general idea that you kind of understand from this passage, right? Well, ask yourself, what was Jesus wanting the original audience to act on? Essentially, he was saying, I am flipping everything that you understand about this universe upside down. Everything that you thought was valuable or cool or praiseworthy is gonna be flipped upside down, and you are going to die to yourself and your sinful, selfish wants and desires, and you're gonna live unto me because that is what I've done to you, because I've died to myself and I'm dying for you on the cross. He wanted them to walk away with a surrendered heart, with a life of worship. Do you get the general idea? So it's not necessarily like a literal application of his words. It's the heart application of his words. So I was just reading today in Genesis 3 with Adam and Eve. They sewed together fig leaves to make clothes after they sinned. I was thinking to myself, like, that's so cool that sewing is included early in the Bible like that. Then I was like, you know what? There's probably some weirdo somewhere on earth that's like, sewing only exists because we sinned. Sewing is like some unholy practice and it's because man fell. If man didn't fall, we wouldn't sew. And I had to chuckle because I was like, I know there's somewhere someone on earth has made that statement. I just had to laugh because a literal application of Genesis 3:7 would say, oh, sewing is only a product of the fall. But we want an application of the verse that goes to the heart, not to the literal. So the heart application of that verse would be they had to scramble. They had to work to cover up their brokenness. And even that wasn't sufficient because God still knew about the fall. You know, that would be more of the heart application. And the heart application would then lead me to say, where do I try and scramble and cover up my sin? Where do I try and scramble and hide my sin from the Lord? There's a difference between the literal application and the heart application. And oftentimes we'll lean towards heretical applications or even just like a shallow application if we just focus on the literal application. You know, sewing isn't the problem here. It's the trying to cover up of your sins. That's the heart problem here. Now, this isn't my idea. This isn't all original content of mine. I've learned this in seminary, but Matt Chandler kind of penned the phrase, you are not David. And I've mentioned that a few times on here because it really transformed the way I viewed God's word. What he was talking about there is like in a sermon on David and Goliath. And we so often read that passage of scripture and we say, we assume that we are David. Okay, if I'm David, what are the giants I'm facing? He's like, that's not how you're supposed to read it. That's not how you're supposed to apply it to your life. In fact, he says, if we were David, we would have failed. We wouldn't have hit Goliath in the head. It was God working through him. And it was, you know, a picture of Jesus to come. So Matt Chandler really brought it home when he reminded us to read the scriptures, not as we are the main character, but rather what is the underlying story of redemption that God is doing. And don't get me wrong, nobody does this perfectly. I was tempted to do this a lot when I was writing the questions and prayer topics for the Bible reading plan. It's really easy to make ourselves the center of the story. If you are wanting to find a way to have a flawless application with no matter what you read, always ask yourself not me-centered questions, but God-centered questions. How is God acting behind this? And why is he doing this? And it's always for his glory, but how is this pointing to Jesus? How is this done through Jesus? How is this done in love, etc.? Now, a big part of our Bible reading plans is gonna be in the Old Testament. The Old Testament is tricky because it's before the cross. So if you're reading something in the Old Testament and you're like, okay, why is God doing this? Why is there so much language in Leviticus about the law? Or why is there so much language here about genealogies? Remember, it's always pointing to the cross. So that's a key part of the application there. So how did the cross fulfill this? How was the cross a promise fulfilled here in the Old Testament? You get what I'm saying? And then how does this impact the way that I view the cross? So if you're struggling with application, definitely ask, what is God doing? Why is God doing it? And always remember, it's for his glory. Oftentimes, if it's in the Old Testament, it's pointing to the cross. If it's in the New Testament, oftentimes it's pointing to the end. It's pointing to the redemption of all things promised to us, Revelation 21, right? If you're still struggling seeing the promises that were fulfilled by the cross, or still struggling seeing why is this genealogy included, always, always, always remember, look up a sermon on the passage. Literally just go to Google and type in like, okay, 2 Samuel, random chapter, sermon, and look it up. There are a lot of good pastors. Find yourself some that you really enjoy. Find yourself some pastors or some commentaries that you can continually just go to and read their thoughts on that passage or listen to their thoughts on that passage. Do not be afraid to dive into other people's thoughts. And I encourage you that a sermon sometimes is the best way to finish your Bible study for the day because you can listen to it while you move on through your day. While you close your Bible, you move on, you go do dishes or you get dressed for the day. Listen to that sermon and will cement the passage that you just read into your heart and your mind even more so. Now, if you guys want to understand how I Bible study even deeper, like how I understand passages, no matter what passage it is, check out this playlist here. Or if you guys would like to hear about how I take notes in my Bible so that I can remember them forever and learn from them forever, check out this video here. And I will see you guys in those videos. Bye guys.